Look at you. Look at you. I love you. I'm so glad to be back in the studio. It's been 12 months, 365 days, one whole year without you. But look at us now. We are stronger, we are braver, and we are fierce. We all emerged from this mess together. And now I'm back. And better than ever. But before we get into today's show, I wanted to take a minute and talk about what you've all heard in the media. There have been so many rumors and so many lies about me. Lies. During quarantine, I did a lot of things that I'm not proud of, which you can read all about in my new book, Quarantine and Me. Available for a discounted price today in the studio. Yes, that's right. And I will even sign them. And for all of you at home, we can mail the book to you at a special discounted price of $19.95. How amazing is that? But before we go on, I want you to know that everything I do is for you, my fans, my lifeblood, and my paycheck. I'm kidding, of course. But when the headlines came out about how I didn't make my staff wear masks, you stood by me. And then the news about my affair, you stood by me. And when I got sick, you stood by me. And when you saw the footage of my yelling at the doctors, well, we all lose our temper every now and again. And you stood by me. Your loyalty inspired me to do better. It inspired me to make the show bigger and better. That is why I'm back here. It's all because of you. When I almost died last year, I only thought about you. Because at the end of the day, I'm just like you, a girl from the Bronx with big dreams, a girl who will never take no for an answer. And a girl who gets what she wants. I get what I want. And now that COVID is a distant memory, thanks in part to my generous contribution, I will never forget your loyalty. Never forget your letters and your comments, how you fought for me. We cry together and we will rebuild together. Okay, enough about me. Let's get on with the show. Next up is the man, the myth, the legend, Will Smith. Wait. And don't forget to order your copy of my book, which is soon to be a bestseller today.
I get that special feeling, you know, like things are gonna come my way, baby. Well, you might say, what are you doing drinking in a bar before noon? This, it's just water. I can't have anything stronger than that. Not even coffee. No. You see, I need a clear head. I'm a trader on the Wall Street. I just like the floor, you know. I like walking on Wall Street, smelling that air of money. Every day I go into work, and as long as I still have red scent, I will play the odds. You see, I have a system here, and no one can steal that away. And let me tell you, people have tried to steal my money so many times, I don't even bother counting anymore. See, I'm rich. Yeah. In this country, money is everything. Oh, don't give me that look. You know what I'm talking about. See, you smile, and it's beautiful. I was born rich, and let me clue you in. It was hard work. It was. Only instead of earning money, I had to learn how to keep it. At first, it wasn't so bad. When you're 13 and you realize you have enough money to last 100 lifetimes, it's like you're walking on the clouds. Everyone is nice to you. You can do no wrong. And then one day, I thought to myself, wait a minute, why is nobody talking to me about my money? My money! Mine! And that's when I learned on my 16th birthday that I was no longer filthy rich. Oh, love, stay a while longer. I'm still rich, see? By an American mile. The problem was my two uncles and my one aunt, they seemed fit to divest my inheritance into their investments. It was gradual, you see, and they did it expertly, I have to say. Every year on my birthday, they'd make transfers to their offshore accounts for Rob's future funds. Only I was not the beneficiary. Their children were. These are the same people that comforted me when my parents died when I was 6. It was an accident. Only, was it really? So what choice do I have? I started working hard. You should have seen me pouring through legal documents. Suing each and every last one of their asses. That's how I got my money back. And I've learned a few tricks of my own. You see, I'm not drunk, I'm not high, well, a different kind of high, perhaps. On the knowledge that I have so much money, I can buy all the bars on this block if I wanted to. There's no such thing as having too much money, because people will be so nice when you're rich, even if you're just messing with them. You know what I'm talking about, don't you, love? See, I'm addicted. I want more. I'll, see you around, love. Everybody wants more.
Of all the ways you could have done this, you chose this! A letter! Is this the best you could do? Is this what I deserve, Tina? Oh, this line right here. Wow, you've got some nerve. We knew this was coming, so I'd rather stop now instead of continuing, knowing that we're not going to be always happy forever. I cherish you, Tomcat. I just think it's best. Oh, here we are at the start of a pandemic, and I am going through a surprise breakup. I already bought you an engagement ring! My mom told me about you. She called it. She was right. You're no good. No good for me. A user. That's what you are. Oh my God, this is like deja vu. My judgment is so off. I'm so stupid sometimes. No, Thomas. You are not going to beat yourself up again over another... failed. You know what? You're not going to do what you always do. You're not going to call her and beg for reasons why. You're not going to cry yourself to sleep. Nope. Not this time, Thomas. Not this time. You're going to make a statement. You're going to make her feel the way she's making you feel right now. Get her where all of her ex-boyfriends see her. On Facebook. Okay, there we go. You see this table, Tina?
This is where I planned out my engagement surprise for you. This is where I set up my laptop and sat for hours to find the perfect princess cut ring for your frail ring finger. This is where I looked my mom in the eyes and convinced her that you were the one after she shook her head for 10 minutes and walked out. See this? It's going right in the garbage along with my heart, which you've torn out of my chest, Tina. You weren't the best cook, but I got my act down really well when you had made that excuse for that onion soup. Oh, and this cheese, it stinks. Just like this does. Take a look at all this, Tina. It's Mount Trashmore and a waste of my hard-earned money on your cooking experiments. You see this daybed, Tina? This is where we had our first kiss after a night of Netflix and chilling on our first date. That was easy, huh? You see this stove? This is how our love burned. So I thought. Now that you've burned our love down to the ground, and what's left of us, huh, Tina? Perhaps I should learn how to cook. I had to put up with your subpar signature turkey bacon and scrambled eggs. I never liked turkey bacon anyway. Wash it away. Just wash it away, Tina. That's right. Just wash it all the way. You know, there comes a time in everyone's life when they just gotta stop and drink a good cup of Joe. Or wine. And remember, that there are better things in life than relationships. Oh, am I kidding? You are missing out, Tina. You are. I have my life together. And what do you have, huh? All those exes who call you 20 times a day. I was your doormat. I know it. I guess it took COVID and the reality that you have to show your true colors for me to really see it. I just want to put this message out there to all of your exes on Facebook and to you, Tina. I am just doing fine. I'll be okay. The question is, will you? When would you stop lying to yourself about what you really want? It wasn't cool what you did, but you know what? I'm bigger than that. And you can have it. You can have this carefree. Oh, Tina. Hi, Tina. I miss you too. Please come home, baby. Me and Rufus are sick and worried about you. Come on, baby. I know. I forgive you. I know.
Give me the baking pan. Give it! This was just to get you here. You're not teaching me how to make your famous cinnamon buns. Don't look so confused. Here. Here's some whiskey to mix with that water, and don't you dare get up, or so help me, you will not have a baby sister anymore. This isn't for you to decide, okay? All I need is for you to be on board. To loan me your van and to not be the controlling, gotta be your way all the time older sister. Sit down. You have to listen to me. I'm not gonna let you talk me out of this. We would have gone last year if we could have, but you couldn't go anywhere last year. Look, I don't give a crap if you think it's right. You don't know. I mean, I know you think you do, but really neither of us know what it's like to lose a child. All our lives, Mom worried about the family curse she thought we had. Every one of our uncles losing a child. And somewhere under that Southie Boston touch my kid and I'll kill ya attitude, just like the one you have, the specter of one of us dying haunted her. But she didn't lose a child. Our sister did. So maybe the curse is real, but right now all I care about is that it's been here. Tomorrow. And Holly has to come back, has to get out of the house, has to stop binging on Doritos and Paw Patrol, and you have to help. And not your way. My way. The best way for Holly. Don't even close your mouth. Close. I know what you're gonna say. Because I don't have kids, you think you know more about this than I do. But this isn't about Hunter. This is about Holly. Our sister. No! Sit down! You infuriate me in your need to be right big sister mode. Holly was always the peacemaker between us, and I bet you don't even know the half of it. Like when you used to take my Barbie's heads off because I dared to play with yours. Holly would pop them back on and brush their hair. Or when you would bike away with your friends, Holly would guide me back with a game of hide and seek. So you don't get to say that she loves us both. She loves us both. And she's broken. And she's been broken a year. And it's time for her to come back. I'm not saying to stop grieving because she never will. But I need her back. Back to me. Back to us. Because if she doesn't come back soon, I'm afraid she never will. And I need you, our big sister, to loan me your stale, Go-Gurt-smelling crasher van. So I can take Holly away, remind her that the world isn't about death and distance, and that somewhere out there, Hunter's angel is going to find us a playground. So we can remember what it was to be kids. We're taking a journey back to Bonnaroo, just like college. We've been vaccinated, the festival's open, we're gonna sleep in a tent, not shower for days, drink beer beyond human sanity, and bump uglies with strangers, and let life drift us into a purple haze of healing, and... Oh, crap. I didn't mean for you to cry. I love you, you weird control freak. And if you don't want to lend me your van, then just come drift with us at Bonnaroo. And we'll light lanterns to let loose into the sky, saying goodbye to control, to hurt, to headless Barbie dolls and old bicycles, and to Hunter. And we'll hold Holly. All here together. And you can bring your famous cinnamon buns.
No one has any concept of time these days. 12:15. I specifically told them class was to start at 12:15, and now it's 12:30. This is not okay. Do they think I have nothing better to do with my day than just stare at a screen? Morning class. I am so excited for our Zoom meeting tomorrow at 12:15 p.m. We are going to be reading excerpts of A People's History of the United States, followed by a lively discussion. Sincerely yours, in friendship, education, and growth, Mr. Bane Iverson. That was pretty clear. I even said lively. Shouldn't they have realized that the class was going to be fun and engaging? And this was a good lesson I prepared. Where are they? Maybe the closing note was a bit much, but maybe they think I'm a bit much. I don't know how I'm supposed to do this online schooling, this mess. Like, what are we even doing? I'm supposed to make hormonal teenagers take a class online during a friggin' pandemic. They barely came to my class when we were stuck together in that building. Shouldn't we all just stop everything now? Not try to pretend like nothing's going on? Like, the world isn't falling apart? Like, I'm not falling apart. I'm fine. They're fine. We are all doing just fine. I know what I need. I need sleep and to meditate, to exercise, and yet my mind is all so murky. It's like I'm on the edge or something. But I can't crack. They need me. They really do. Don't they know how much I care about them? Know how much I do for them? Where are they? Why are they doing this to me? Don't they know? Don't they know that I stayed up all night panning over their stupid papers? Some papers, which, by the way, sound like a fifth grader wrote them. But that's a whole other issue. And all I do all damn day is plan and write emails and talk to their annoying parents. And no, Mrs. Davis, your son is not a genius. It's too much. This is all too much. Maybe I should look into teeth whitening. I don't remember them looking so tired. Listen to me. My teeth can't be tired. I really just need to get sleep. I need a break. I need this disease to go away. And it doesn't matter what I think. It doesn't matter what anyone thinks anymore. We have to stay up late, get up early, grind away, and wait. So much waiting. What about what I want? Wasting my time. They're not coming. They're never coming. That's too bad for them. This is one damn fine lesson. Probably my best.
Is it time yet? Is it time yet? You won't tell me. Why? I remember yesterday. Was it yesterday? Of course. Sunday. It was last Sunday. Yes, I'm sure of it. It was last Sunday at breakfast. Or was it lunch? Or brunch or whatever. Tom winked at me. Me. Oh, I've had my sights set on that man since I moved here. He must use some really nice teeth whitening kits, because I could use those things as a mirror if I'm lucky. So we set a date. I may not remember my own name sometimes, but something about Tom just stuck with me. He reminds me of someone. Doesn't matter. We set a date, and it's I don't remember. I don't remember. I must have written it down somewhere. I'm sure I've written it down. I know I've written it down. I'm not stupid. I just need to calm down. Calm down. Remember that song, that deja vu song? I live by the sea. Rainbow colored people. Yeah, come down. Beat this, Charlie. You can beat this. Where are the nurses? It's 8 o'clock and no one's called for breakfast. I remember being hungry. Maybe Nurse Troy can help me find my book. Yes. Book. Which book? Troy? Oh yeah. I haven't seen Tom since last Friday. He winked at me. What? Troy. I remember something now. Troy said they were sterilizing the apartments because some virus? Some kind of flu? Troy! Yeah. Troy looks worried. He had this face mask on. I mean, he usually hides behind his smiles, but can't fool me. Charlie, ex-military. Police? I mean, friends called me Sarge, so I was in command of something. What was I going on about? Troy? I saw Tom. That's right, I saw Tom last night. Troy was taking him somewhere. Where was he taking him? I almost missed them because Troy, he was telling me to stay back in that tone. Something about a cough and the virus. And Tom wouldn't talk to me. He was covering his face. No, he wasn't covering his face. He was wearing a mask. Yeah. I gotta find Troy and talk to him about Tom. Troy? I have my eyes on that one. He has such a nice personality and he can paint. He's always saying to me, you know, you take such good care of those plants in the dining room. I'm gonna paint them for you and give them to you so that you can have them forever. He's a sweet man. And we have a date. Oh yeah. The date! And it's... it's today! Where is Troy? Oh, I have to tell him Tom and I have a date! He's gonna be so happy for us! I have to tell him before I forget, and then it's just deja vu all over again. Should I dress hot or cold? I used to be a queen, you know. By an island by the sea. Rainbow colored people. Troy?
You're supposed to be the one I can always count on. You, me, theater besties, always here for each other. Ugh, don't look at me with those panda eyes, trying to find some kind of innocence that you don't currently have the right to. We're only halfway through the Grand Theater journey. And yes, Hong Kong Rep and Shanghai Grand were wonderful. But why bother going to Shanza Opera when the memories I thought we were going to make here in Hangzhou seem to be different from what you thought? You're seriously telling me you're thinking of staying here in Wuhan? You're not making any sense. You can't stay here. And don't try your logical countering balance argument. Those used to work in college, but were 20 years older and wiser. Please sit back down. I know you better than anyone. Nope. Quiet. You don't get to talk. As a matter of fact, you don't get to even think or feel or breathe. Oh, if I could make that happen, those Chinese stars we bought could probably cut deep enough. I'll bet it's real easy to dump a body between here and Shanza. You think I'm kidding? Fine. But this is only because you want to explore the lovely Mei Shen. You should explore. I get that. She's Lucy Liu's doppelganger. I mean, we're on a journey, so why not? Do you think I didn't explore that hot dancer, Dong Hai, in Shanghai? Do you really think I stayed out all night looking at water lilies? The only water lily opening that night was mine. Oh, don't give me that mock shock. I know you better than that. Since our pinky swear pack at Camp Arena, we will always share the spotlight, walk the tightrope, swing from the trapeze, scare the audience, love the audience, thrill, and thrive on action and intentions. Break the fourth wall. Live in cheap New York studios together until we can afford more. And now we can. So we come to China and see the Monkey King in person, drive the back roads to find hidden shadow puppetry, explore remnants of spoken drama and song drama, but uproot your whole life for someone you've only known for 4 days. Don't get mad at me for telling the truth. You aren't staying here. There's no way around it. And no, at this moment, I don't care what you think you need or want to feel, because you're under some spell of Chinese mysticism combined with a flexible acrobat who can wrap around you like a snake. Do you know what I do with snakes? I cut their heads off. Look. If you tell me you love her only after 4 days, I won't believe you, but I'll back off. But if this is just another adventure, then please come home to our 3 a.m. music sessions, trying to keep the pages clean while learning our lines over my sticky honey barbecue, geeking out together with quantum physics documentaries. And yes, someday we'll fall in love. But not today, not February 2020 in China. I need you not to live halfway around the world. I need us. Wait, are you crying? Oh, I didn't mean to make you cry. Well, okay, maybe I did, but I'm all emotion, so I use what I got. And now you're laughing? Well, if I knew emotion would get you, then I could have saved us some time. I love you, my theater bestie. Really, you can stop crying now. Oh, that's coughing? It's kind of bad. Here, get some water. Mm-hmm. Oh, I think you might have a fever too. Good thing our tour is over. Time to get out of Wuhan and... Oh, the stuff we shipped from Hong Kong for our new apartment should be there soon. 2 bedrooms in the city. Did you ever think we could afford that? Barbecue our first night back and binge watching Lucy Liu movies. Good besties forever.
Thank you. sorry, Mama. That was pretty awful. Well, not really awful, but not at all like how we practiced it for so many hours and so many days. I just wanted you to be pleased with me. I just wanted you to see how much I loved the music and how much I cared about everything, but you never believed in me. You always said you did, but I know better. I can see it all so clearly now. And look at you, so still, so quiet. Did it give you that special feeling that you said James Calloway makes you feel? Of course not. But maybe, maybe one day, I'll get there. You look so cold, so far away. I want nothing more than to help you, Mama, but I'm at a loss. I just want you to tell me what to do or tell me what you need, but there's nothing. Will you ever tell me anything ever again? The doctors say that you're getting better, that there's looking up, but I don't get it. You're still asleep. You still can't talk. You still can't move. You can't laugh. You can't hug. You're just lying there like a lump on a log. I had scrambled eggs and turkey bacon for breakfast today. I know it's like your favorite thing ever, but I wanted to try it to see what all the fuss was about. And you know, it wasn't as disgusting as I thought, but I probably wouldn't ever eat it ever again. But I tried it. That's something? I am trying so hard, Mama. I'm trying so hard to be okay and trying to live life like nothing ever happened to you, but I... I came here today to tell you that I am trying out for the flute competition in March. The one in New Jersey? Yeah. As that means I won't really be able to see you for, well, I guess that doesn't really matter. I know that you said I wasn't ready, but I think I have a chance. I think I can do everything that you never believed in. I can do hard things, and you know, this whole experience, it's made me kind of hopeful. I mean, it's just the beginning of the year. Anything could happen. I could win the flute competition. Crazier things have happened. Mama, can you hear me? I can do this. Our journeys are different from each other. Look where yours got you. Alone, in a hospital bed with no sign of that man that you groveled down to. Is this the life you wanted for yourself? Is it? I guess none of us really want to end up broken.
Thank you.
really hope you can hear me, Mama. That was for you. It's always been for you.
Scent. God! I thought it was never gonna end. Oh, it's been quite a journey. Me and my quarantine journal. Sure, it was novel at the beginning. The streets were quiet. Can you imagine? No car in sight on Fifth Avenue. I don't think this ever happened before. There's always something. A dozen horse-drawn carriages, perhaps. And the hustling and bustling. Always the hustling and the bustling. And then suddenly everything stopped. I was writing an article on the competitiveness of local theaters. And then, you know, just one invisible swat of the hand, my article and the city took a dark turn. My writer friends panicked. I was the first one to cry on our first Zoom call. Of course. All my theater friends got drunk. Though they always got drunk, I think. And started sending me messages, requests for insider information, as if I was some sort of authority on dealing with pandemics. I was in denial too. But whenever I needed a shoulder to cry on, I listened to the OJs cry together. Except for this time, I wasn't crying over my ex-girlfriend who cheated on me. For my city, my New York City. I had so many tears. I knew that I had to keep on writing. And then BLM happened, and all my friends started going out in the streets again, except for this time for justice for Black people, because we saw clearly now, more than ever, what systemic racial injustice does to the vulnerable. I went out with my friends, observing social distancing, of course, and we all felt this energy, like people are finally waking up. It was one of the most meaningful things I think I've ever done. My boyfriend suggested that I should start a website documenting the events of the day-to-day. With him taking charge of the visual presentation and me writing articles, we made a website, blackpaint.com. And all of our friends supplied pictures of marches and like hauntingly empty streets and closed theaters with upbeat or downbeat signs and the occasional people hurrying somewhere. They all had this haunting look on their faces as if they were moving in a dream. But that was behind us in a New York minute. Well, almost. They developed a vaccine over a month ago. It's now freely available, in abundance, over the counter, thanks to the city's coordination. And with people's renewed enthusiasm for scientific facts, when Dr. Fauci personally vouched for the vaccine, everyone trusted the expert and got inoculated. I still remember when I was in line for mine. I was still wearing a mask, so was everyone else. Out of habits now. And maintaining our distances. Everyone around me looked relieved. It was like we were all casting our vote. I remember looking around, seeing the people of my city. Every skin tone and face mask with all sorts of goofy designs.
One says, hello, the smiley face. Another says, not Will Smith. And I just thought, we're gonna be okay. Yeah. We made it. But, the work is just beginning.
Over the river and through the woods to grandmother's house we go, and you're going with me all of the way along the ocean road. Road trip! 8-hour car journey, 8 lobster shacks. Hot versus cold. Butter versus mayo. When we get there, we'll just roll into the ocean. Kennebunkport Clam Shack. Harasika in South Freeport, Two Lights, Five Islands, Booth Bay Lobster, Muscungus Bay, McLoon's, right up the coast, and we will end at Hometown Ellsworth Lobster Shack. They all have takeout if you're a wimp, but Maine has only had like 3,500 cases and like 100 deaths in 1.3 million Mainers and 36,000 square miles. We'll be fine. Don't look at me like that. The bubble is down. Maine is one of the only states in that like lighty pink. It's safe. You should want to go there. And Graham has made all these lobster themed masks for the whole family to keep the celebration safe. We have all this planned for Graham's birthday. How many nights did we spend snuggled under this baby clothes quilt she made, planning every detail? And I know it was winter, but we can still go. It's not like it's March. It's been months of social distancing. This is gonna be our first big trip. Coming out as a couple, you know, meet the fam, see a new place. Ocean, lobster, taffy, all those silly touristy things that you'll love once we get there. And Grams is gonna love you. The first time you ask her to show you how to make her world famous whoopie pie recipe, she won't be able to resist. And you can share your baklava recipe. We've even got some phyllo dough in the freezer that we can bring. The way to Graham's heart is through her stomach, especially with new people. I mean, well, not new, just she's never met you before. I didn't mean anything by it, the coming out crack. No, wait, don't get out of bed. Okay, look. I haven't told him yet that we're a couple. I know I should have, but wouldn't it be better if they meet you in person first? Like, I fell in love with you face to face. Be honest, if we had met online, do you really think we'd still be together? You know, that we would have felt this special feeling? I don't think so. You're irresistible in person. All of you. And if we go, you know, mask to mask, elbow to elbow, then they'll meet you, and then, well, it's a great way for them to confirm what they already suspected anyway. And then it's all good, right? Don't look at me like I've just broken your heart. I love you. And I want this for us, but it just has to be at the right time.
in person. I want to do all of this with you. I want to do trips and family and discoveries, anything, everything with you. And trust me, if Gramps loves you, they all will, and then everything will be good. I promise. I'm sorry I didn't tell them. I should have, months ago. But please, let's just be ourselves. Really ourselves. Maybe my first time really being me, it's all because of you. So if you'll stay, if we, you know, road trip together, binging on lobster, then you'll meet the woman who made me this baby clothes quilt that we lie under each night. And I know she'll be on our side. Please? Say yes. To grandmother's house we go.
Discipline. What this world needs now more than ever is discipline. Without it, there can be no growth.
And if you don't grow, you might as well be dead. Something is coming. It's there, just there, out of sight. Like a runaway car. On a very narrow and very long street. There's no way around it. And if you know, you know. Most people just let things be told to them, accepting it with alacrity and no thought of rebuttal. Day in and day out, it's the same. More concerned with their teeth whitening than the quality of their water. But if you're watching this, you might be different. If you're watching this, you've been inspired. Feels familiar, yes? Like you've been here before. But fear not. We are on this journey together now. A lot of people are going to get sick soon. A lot of people are going to die. The virus comes closer. The world's uneasy. The people you can trust are going to change drastically, but when you find them, the discipline, the weight, it'll all be worth it. And there will come a day where we can laugh together again, a day where we can cry together again.
You will know us by our symbol. And its black paint will be your guide. We are counting on you. Find Dr. Will Smith, he can help you. If they get their hands on the vaccine first, they will destroy it. Husk is getting closer to merging machine and man. What he will use them for is yet to be seen, I'm afraid. But if I know him, it cannot be good. You cannot fail. You have no choice. Operation Deja Vu has already begun.
After 5 months, finally found him. Dr. Will Smith and the rest of Operation Deja Vu. I followed the black paint across the country and met like-minded companions. Not only alike in mind, but alike in heart, too. That didn't end so well, as you can see. I would have found him quick sooner if everything hadn't shut down so quick. Quarantine was a surprise, and it made traveling all this way extremely difficult. It really threw a wrench in my plans. At first. Then I realized how much of a boon it was to my quest. You know what it did? It gave me time to see where the pieces were going to fall. Let the board be set. It was a good way to sift through the muck, let the water wash the dirt from the gold, so to speak. Husk's automatons were even worse. They mocked us with their fabricated smiles and open arms. Arms ready to snap shut if you got too close. And if they find you, you better run like hell. It takes a lot to ditch them, to get them off your trail. I suppose that's how they found me. Found headquarters. They must have picked up my scent somewhere along the way, but I was so careful. I swear I was careful. And now I have all this blood on my hands. This is the formula for the vaccine. I saved it. Dr. Smith completed it right before he... The explosion was so big. I doubt anyone survived. And if they did, they were one of the lucky ones. I have to pass this along. Dr. Smith, if you're out there, if you're somehow alive and you somehow see this, meet me at the place you mentioned the last time we talked. To everyone else, follow the signs. Follow the black paint. You know, someone once told me that without discipline, there can be no growth. And if you aren't growing, you're dead. We have to keep going until this ends. We have to keep going until this virus is eradicated.
Dr. Will Smith, recording the latest message for the archives of Operation Deja Vu. I suppose I'm only recording this point for posterity's sake. I have no task, I have no mission to pass on. Once this is uploaded, I will be done. I wish only to save what will prove impossible come dawn. But by the time that the sun peeks through the cracks of my makeshift panic room, I will be eradicated. Sounds terrible, I know, but the quarantine has been insufferable. But not more insufferable than being Husk is flailing and sending his automations in a last-ditch effort to win. They destroyed my labs over and over again, hoping that something in my paperwork and my laptop would clue them in into what we discovered. It's too late. If I'm successful, which I will be, the virus will surely be joining me soon thereafter. Then the world can heal. God. What I wouldn't do for some turkey sausage and scrambled eggs. I would kill for that. Would I? Yeah, I definitely would. I would have that creamy, cheesy eggs and crispy cardboard, almost bacon, crunching between my teeth would be you know. The mouthfeel is the most of it, you know. Yeah. Finished. You're too late. We survived. The truth survived. That's it, folks. Till we meet again. I am young, I am old, I am rich, and I am poor. I feel like I've been on this earth many times before. And I can feel it for sure, I've been here before. Call it deja vu. Call it deja vu.
This is my father's house. He says he wants you to leave by Tuesday or next weekend at the absolute latest. He says your mother did not own this house. He let her stay after he left her for my mother. Or she left him for Messiah. The whole he said, she said thing is pretty boring, actually, and I don't hold much interest in it. I'm just the messenger, okay? Don't shoot the messenger. He says he doesn't want any trace of you or her left in this house after you move. He says she wanted the blue walls. He wants them white again. He said it's up to you to find somebody to repaint them. I told him I didn't want to come tell you all this. And I was working all day, and you want me to go to George Street to tell all this to someone that I once... And he said, yes, Serene, you are my daughter until it ends. That house is your inheritance. Go collect it before I die too. He said he waited till after the pandemic to deliver this message. He said it was the extent of his kindness. Go, Serene. Collect your inheritance before I die too. I can't imagine the tenor of life without him, and I think your mother dying in the middle of all this scared me out of my mind. She was kinder to me than my own father, my own mother. I don't think I've even mourned. Perfect. I had to sit up straight and speak correct and never bring undue attention to myself. So I learned to hide myself inside myself. And that one weekend when my father let me come here to the city with Lionel, we were like 15, and all five of us, me, you, your mom, Lionel, Messiah. We repainted the walls that bright, bright blue. A whole world opened up and we laughed and played Tina Marie on your mom's record player. Those bright blue walls held so much of what and who I wanted to be. And I remember the extraordinary love between Messiah and your mother, and not being able to explain it because I'd never seen it between my own parents. And I felt bitter, jealous, and resentful of you, Jasmine, not of Lionel, of course, but mostly of you. I think all that was misplaced. It was to him, to them, and their picture-perfect suburban life that I could never measure up to. Not to you at all. So I'm collecting my inheritance, but I'm choosing it to. I'm not going to carry his dreams anymore. So if you want help painting the walls black, green, or blue, anything but white.
When Messiah died, you did the eulogy too. And held Mama while Lionel pretended he was not of her womb. He looked just like his daddy, who was white. I looked too much like Mama. I hate eulogies. I always think I've learned enough about death to be prepared when it come again. I'm always wrong. It is always bitter. There is never enough water to wash myself clean after. I've been here before. Anyway. Welcome to the celebration of somebody's life and somebody's death. And maybe that's the same thing after all, and maybe we all dying right now. But you ain't here to hear me talk about death. You're here to talk about life. So, Mama's name was Christina, but she started going by Tina, like T-I-N-A, because she loved Tina Marie. She wanted to spell it the same like T-E-E-N-A, but Nana ranted and raved because she wanted Mama to have her own things. And she say, it do something to a black girl to be forever carrying a white girl's name, even if she was the Ivory Queen of Soul. So, Mama been Tina since 1980, when she was 15. I grew up on Tina Marie's notes that would reach way up and back down again. And to Mama swaying her hips to deja vu with Messiah. And when Lionel came to visit, we'd dress up like we were queen and king of that island by the sea with rainbow colored people, happy as can be. We'd fill the bathtub till it was almost spilling over and stand on the edge, surveying our kingdom, which extended from the bathroom past the bedroom we shared with the purple carpet and all the way to the top of the stairs. I remember one time I wanted to be king and Lionel wanted to be queen, so we traded clothes. And it wasn't a big thing. It wasn't no thing at all. We just could be. Lionel was 3 years older, but Mama said, girls mature faster, Jasmine, so you a woman before you know you a girl. And I think she was talking about herself and not really me at all. Eulogies are supposed to be about the dead, not the dying. I'm sorry. I wanna say something nice and pretty. I wanna bring you comfort in this death. I wanna sing you a hymn that makes you feel held. But there's no holding for me. I don't know how to mourn now. Mama died from another pandemic. What is it to love while black and lose your love to war against our spirits? Mama Saya died from addiction to Reagan's beast. Mama slowly wasted, slowly tired, slowly stopped getting up. My Saya, my second mother, Mama's lover, my Saya, who helped Mama repaint the walls blue each summer, who kissed my knees when I scraped them, who loved to laugh. Oh, who loved to laugh a lot. Conduct a funeral in an empty house. Mama had my Saya, me, and Lionel. That's it. And Lionel did not know Mama, cause he could not see Mama. I always saw. Why I always gotta see? Why I always gotta carry? Ooh, I'm sorry. I've never recorded a eulogy before, though I've done 1,000, or what feels like 1,000. I try not to keep record. when we are together, I can cry. Or stutter. And know that you'll have some grace for me. I'll know tomorrow you'll not really remember. Now we mourn through screens and solitude. But perhaps there has only ever been us talking into the void, in this place where we are forever strangers, where we have known a trillion pandemics. Mama, I hope you are dancing to Tina Marie where you be. I hope you are seen where you be. I hope you are holding my sire where you be. I hope you are safe where you be. I'm sorry I don't have a better eulogy. I hope you can forgive me where you be. Love.
I made something of myself in spite. Dad says you did not and could not teach me how to be a man. How could you? You, sitting up here in this house with Messiah. How could you teach me how to live a righteous and upstanding life? How to keep a home? How to raise a family? You. I made something of myself in spite of you. Dad says you're his biggest regret and says nothing of me. I went to college and I got a career and I learned how to work really hard. And I've got a closet full of three-piece suits. And I am the kind of man that people are inspired by. And I talk with men who look like Dad, who walk like Dad, who think like Dad. And they say that I'm doing real, real well. I'm doing real well. And I can buy a house, a car, now, with no loans. And I can stand up next to anyone and say, look how great I am. Look how strong I am. I can buy out a whole stadium. It's true. It's true. Lately, I've had a hard time separating my own memory, my own thoughts from things Dad has always said. He cut me out as well. Says everything I own will go to Sharece. Sharece. He says he could not have a son who bears the same shame as you. And he shakes his head and says, my biggest regret, and this time he is talking about me too. And he takes my pictures down from the walls. And he says, at least I have one perfect child named Serene who will marry someone like me, who will have a bunch of babies who will all be perfect too. How could you have a child like me with him and not shield me with your life? Who were you then to marry someone like that? You and Dad are planets apart, like hot and cold. As a kid, nothing made sense at all. The weekends seemed like these strange interludes, these moments where I could just be for once. I'd wait all week for Saturday when me and Jasmine's favorite game was to pretend we were the king and queen of our own island with our own rules. We'd fill up the bathtub till you yelled we were running up your water bill. And then we'd stand at the edge of the tub, wearing crowns we made from newspapers, and just imagine the bluest and brightest sky. We'd imagine going on journeys in the deepest seas, and I felt more like myself then than I have in my entire life. Until now. And I'm sorry for bringing all this to you now. I haven't been here in a while. And this might sound strange, Mama, but I have this sense that something is coming that is going to change everything. And I have this feeling that I have to do and be and love the entirety of myself before I can't anymore. So I'm getting married, Mama. And I want you to meet him. And I want you to walk me down the aisle.